turn on my timer and I can go. Okay. Hello everyone, my name is Piotr LEWANDOWSKI and this presentation will not be about China at all. It's gonna be about Central Eastern European transition countries. It's actually the second time I'm coming for a conference here and speaking about the region. The first time was a year and a half ago for the conference about population aging. Albert mentioned yesterday that it's organized, the conference is financed by the Network for Jobs and Development, actually the institute that I work in Poland with European partners. So that's the context, let's say, institutional of why we work together. So that presentation will be about the evolution of task content of jobs in Central Eastern Europe. So it's not about China. It's actually not about structural change directly. It's more about occupational change. But I think that they are actually quite close to each other, and I'm gonna argue why is that. So the basic question we ask, the basic research question we ask is actually how has the nature of jobs changed across the region? I'm gonna use this photo just to show you the pace of change in the region that happened over the last 25 years since the communist collapse. That terrible building in front, this is like the modernity clash. So that terrible building in front is the new headquarter of Polish public TV, like our BBC, let's say. That terrible building that behind, it's the old headquarter, let's say. Just got dismantled in February this year. I managed to take this photo before it was done. So as you can see, where people work and how it all looks like changed dramatically over the last 25 years. We actually want to ask a question if it's very different what they do inside. Is it really the very different job that they are doing within that building in comparison to the job they were doing in that building 25 years ago? And could you please get me the proper presentation? Because that's not the one. Yes, that's the, sorry guys. The picture will be done again, but there will be like more information about the region. Sorry, that's. It's this one. I mean, Otto Raczymoglu will be there as well, but I need one more before I get there. Sorry? No, it's a proper one, but I needed Otto Levi-Marnay first. So, no, it's older paper, so I have to start with 2003 paper before I move to the 2011. So, let me just see. Yeah, so you have already seen the photo. So that's basically the content. And so we want to ask the question how the nature of jobs changed within the region. And because there were several developments happening, both on the labor demand, on the labor supply side, we want to find some framework that will allow us to unify the labor demand and the labor supply developments. And the framework that we find very attractive to do that is the scale task technologies approach by David Rotor and other authors that I will give a little bit of introduction in a few minutes. And because in the most of the presentation I'll be using these categories that they introduced over 10 years ago, I'm gonna show you the graph from the very known paper from 2003, which basically shows how the content of jobs has evolved in the US from the 1960s until the 2000s. So I guess most of you are familiar with it, but just a quick reminder, what they found is that the non-routine cognitive task, the non-routine cognitive content of jobs has been increasing in the last 15 years in the US, both when we look at the analytical task or interactive, these days they call it interpersonal, rather. On the other hand, you can see that the manual tasks have been declining, and there has also been an inverse U-shaped development in routine cognitive and the other routine manual tasks. So until the, let's say between the 1960s and the 1970s, what was happening, or 1980s, what was happening was the shift into the more non-routine cognitive task or non-routine cognitive content of jobs, decline of manual. But then what's happening later is the decline of routine cognitive. That led the researchers on the topic to argue that instead of skill-based technological change, there is something as routine-based technological change. So the way the technology evolves, the ICT and the robotics that they substitute for the routine task that humans perform and that machines, computers do it better. And on the other hand, that the people who can complement the technology, so they perform rather non-routine tasks, doing them, they benefit more. So we actually want to use this framework and look at what was happening in the Central Eastern European region. And there are basically two, let's say, motivations behind it. On the one hand, we would like to look at the developments in the region with these lenses. On the other hand, we think that if the routine bias technological change is really, I mean, the thing recently, it would be really nice to see that happening not only in the most developed country in the world, like US or maybe Germany. It would be nice to see that happening in the other countries, like middle income countries, if it's really the thing. So just a short, history of that literature. It started with the David Oder papers, with Levi Marnay, also with David Dorn. They actually argued for the routine bias technological change. One, let's say, flaw of this literature is that we don't really observe the technology levels. We have no data about the ICT capital from 1980 or whatever. So most of the reasoning pro and against the routine bias technological change is actually inferred from studying this task content of jobs, how they evolve. We can't really regress with ICT. So, and this body of work focused mainly on the US, but also on Europe. Martin Manning Salomon, or Michaels, Van Rienen, and one more author that I just forgot. For the US, Japan, and nine European countries, they presented evidence that this polarization, that this non-routine growth and routine decline is actually happening. But then again, you have like people actually based in Europe and writing more about European countries, like Daniel Esch or Andrea Salvatori, who argued that labor supply developments matter a lot. One argument which is being raised is that if you look at the US, that non-routine growth actually stopped in the 2000s. It's not happening anymore in the 2000s. Whereas in the UK, it's still happening. And the argument raised by Daniel Esch or Andrea Salvatore is that that was because the number of graduates in the US was relatively flat, whereas in the UK, it was increasing. So the labor supply developments get more attention recently, and also the role of labor market institutions. So how labor market institutions impact this organization of work and the how particular occupations actually evolve. There is also argument by Zofia Barani and Christian Ziegel recently that the entire polarization is the other side of the coin of the old school structural change, and that it actually started in the 50s. And there is also recently a nice paper by David Deming about which argues that the the declining agriculture, rising manufacturing, then shift to services. Like the there is also the argument by David Deming about the importance of social skills, which shows that the computers actually increase the returns from skills which complement computers, and also from soft skills, so to managerial competences and things like that. And he actually even argues that some of the decline in the gender pay gap can be explained by the fact that women on the average have more soft skills. At the same time, there is scarce research for low and middle income countries, and this is the gap that we wanna address here. So empirical strategy for the 10 CE countries that we are using in this paper is to use the ONET, American ONET data set, which provides the information about the data, about the task, about the content of particular occupations. So what kind of task people have to perform in particular occupations is very detailed. Thousands of occupations and several data sets which actually measure different dimensions. And we use the other Acemoglu methodology of translating all these task contents, or these task items, into 5 standard task contents. And we merged that with the EU LFS data from 1998 to 2013. That's basically because of the data availability. We would like to start earlier, but the way European Union works is that it's slightly chaotic even when it comes to statistics. So 1998 is the first year where we have comparable, consistent labor force studies for many European countries. And then we actually, it's quite a painstaking process of merging one data set with another data set, and also tackling the numerous classification changes when it comes to occupational classifications. So one additional benefit is that, for example, if you want to draw a time series of the employment by occupations from 1998 to 2013 for European countries, it's actually not possible if you want to go further than just one digit, 9 main categories, because there are no crosswalks between them, and it's a mess. So we thought that we will just transform all the occupations into bundles of tasks, and we'll look at tasks that people perform rather than focus on the on the name of the occupation that they have according to one or the other classification. So we actually have about this task contents for approximately 130 occupations. So we in general use 3-digit classification codes. And then we calculate 5 annual country level task content measures for each of the countries we study. There is a word of caution here when it comes to using the owned data for the European countries. So the word of caution, if you want to start doing that, is that it's very time consuming to merge one with another. And as my co-author can actually confirm. And the when you do it, there is this basic question: can you really use the American task content of jobs or information about contents of occupations data for middle income European countries? So the one caveat is that we probably have the routine task contents underestimated. So in the middle income countries, the routine content of job is probably a bit higher than in the US. On the other hand, there are several papers, one by Michael Handel from 2012, when he compares the owned data with the content of job measures he's able to calculate for UK, Germany, Italy, and some more countries using the country-specific studies, and he finds that they are actually highly correlated. And there were even more, there were 2 studies, one in Italy and another in Czech Republic, so that's basically a upper middle-income country, which were modeled after ONET, and they found that the correlation between these measures is 85-90%. So we're actually quite safe using them. So let me move to the first result slide. That's the evolution across the region. So 10 Central Eastern European countries, just all together, the average evolution of non-routine cognitive, routine manual, physical task across the region. And it's actually quite a familiar story, especially when it comes to the non-routine cognitive analytical and non-routine cognitive personal task. So they have been increasing over the last 15 years, gradually and in a consistent manner. Both routine and non-routine manual tasks and contents of jobs have been declining. The only thing which is slightly at odds with the literature for the US or Germany and the UK is the inverted pattern for the routine cognitive task. As you could see on the Arthur Levy Marnens graph that I presented earlier, routine cognitive tasks have been increasing there until the end of 70s and then started declining, whereas here in the region it was the other way around. So routine cognitive jobs are task content of jobs are declining over the last 10 years. And that's the average picture. When we move to the picture country by country, we actually, yes. Yes, that's the depolarization concept. And the middle jobs are increasing as well, yes. So if I were, that would be one of my conclusions, that the polarization narrative created for the US, we can't really see it in the like upper middle countries in Europe. It's US. You can see, sorry? No, for the US was different in that sense that the, for the US you have, yes, because the, because for they also, yeah, they have like increasing and declining, and then the other thing that they complement the polarization narrative is that it's also declining, there are also declining wages for the low-skilled workers. So the idea of polarization is that you have, that's a content of jobs. If we were, let's say that, which are the low-skilled, these are the, which one is that? It's rooting cognitive. Rooting cognitive is declining. So the point I have here is that, yeah, actually the manual jobs have been increasing then declining. Then in 2000 they are rather flat, and in 2000 they constitute increasing share of employment but declining share of wage bill. And that's why they talk about polarization, because the wages of low-skilled people decline, the middle-income occupations decline as a number, and the both the employment and wages in high-skilled non-routine jobs increase. So that's the they basically that's 62. That's 62 to 1,000. That one. It's just the. Yeah, there are more. Let's say I'm not necessarily the person to answer the question why they. Actually, the job polarization and the wage polarization. These concepts are really intertwined. So people are using them once or another. Actually, very often meaning the same. So and the common pattern in both like job and wage polarization is the decline of the middling occupations. So those that are in the middle of the wage distribution and the middle of the skill distribution. So from what actually we are most interested in at that in that moment is the increase in the routine cognitive jobs. In the Central Eastern Europe. Behind that increase in the routine cognitive jobs, there is some heterogeneity. So we find that there are countries with increasing routine cognitive tasks, three Baltic states and Romania. There are countries where the routine cognitive content of jobs was rather stable, Czech Republic, Croatia, Poland, Slovakia, and only two with declining, Hungary and Slovenia. On the next few slides, I will present a couple of the compositions, what's actually behind these developments, which I think will. That kind of task is, let's say, a bank teller or an accountant. Or, yes, a bank teller accountant is a good example. Yes. So something which is like a cognitive work, but doesn't necessarily involve solving problems, involves like repeating some kind of task. The bank teller is a good example. So now I'm going to look at the three decompositions. First is just a shift sure look at the evolution of task contents, like within between. So we want to see what's the contribution of changes in the structure of employment. So people moving from one types of occupations into another occupations. That's the between occupation effect. What is the contribution of changes in the task content intensities over time, so it's like within occupation, and here a caveat, it's basically ONET-based, so that's what's happening within the American data, actually, and what's the interaction between the two. So none of you will be surprised by that the between occupation effects are much more powerful than the within occupation effects. So this growth of non-routine analytical, it's the same with non-routine interpersonal tasks, is basically due to increasing share of occupations which have high contents of this kind of task, and not because of increasing content of particular occupations of this kind of task, let's say. So it actually, the you can also see that the higher the overall growth was, the more dominating was this factor. It's somehow similar with the routine cognitive. So the countries like Slovenia, which recorded the substantial decline in the routine cognitive content, they actually moved employment from the occupations intensive in routine cognitive tasks into other occupations. Whereas for countries which were flat or even increasing in routine cognitive content, we find that it's the interaction term that determines the growth. The interaction term means that people moved into the occupations which at the same time experienced increasing content of the routine cognitive task. So as an example, it could be some office job which was not that routine in the late 90s, but became more routine over the next 15 years. And that interaction shows that employment was increasing in that occupations in Estonia, and that drove the overall increase in the routine cognitive tasks. So in a sense, they were caught by surprise by the developments of task content of jobs. With routine manual, that's basically driven by the between effect, and it's to a large extent a decline of agriculture. So some of the countries still have substantial agriculture employment, like Poland has 12% of employment, but it actually declined by 10 percentage points. So the decline of manual jobs is mainly due to manual contents, mainly due to agriculture. The another question we ask is the like the last time I was here was the population aging, so I had to create some reference to that. So the next question we ask is how egalitarian in the cohort and age dimension was that process of the change of the task content of jobs? Was it uniform across the generation, or was it rather related to the fact that there are new people entering the labor market and they perform different jobs than people who were at the labor market in the late 90s? And again, we perform a couple of decompositions, and we find that most of the growth of the non-routine cognitive task can be explained by the contribution or is attributed to cohorts of people born after 1965, in particular after 1973. So most of this growth in non-routine content of jobs was actually due to people who are entering the labor market after transition, graduating after the transitions, basically to labor market entrance over the last 15 years. And again, you can see that, for example, for Poland, the main contribution into the growth of non-routine cognitive task is attributed, the main contribution was by people born between 1974 and 1979-83, these are two bars here, 84-88 as well. For older people, there were like contributions were small or to some extent even declining. When we look at routine cognitive tasks, it's similar but with some difference. Again, the people who were graduating after the transition and entering the labor market in the last 15 years, they actually, in comparison to 1998, experienced a decline of routine cognitive tasks. But at the same time, you could see that the people who were older, like born in the 40s or in the 50s, were experiencing increase in routine cognitive tasks. So there is this some kind of, let's say, polarization by cohort rather than by wages. And when we look at routine manual, it's again these cohorts of entrance, they experience huge declines in the routine in the manual tasks, so they don't really perform this kind of jobs. But for older cohorts, there are even some increases. The way we look at these results is some kind of lump of labor revisited again. So we think that sort of like confirms that these are not really the same kind of jobs that are being performed by the people who are entering after the transitions and where they're on the labor market before the transition. The last exercise we do is to try to merge the evolution of task content of the task content of jobs with we've tried to correlate that with what was happening to the education, what was happening to some proxy for technology adoption. So these are just results of the fixed effect estimation of particular contents of jobs in particular countries. We have like 15 years, 10 countries. And we regress that, that content of jobs against the share of tertiary educated people, the share of primary educated people on the labor market, and R&D related to GDP. That's, again, like no causality here. It's more like finding correlates. And R&D, there are a couple of papers that try to deal with the fact that there is no data on ICT in that region, basically, it's lacking on the ICT capital. So they use the R&D to GDP as a proxy for the level of ICT and technology. So the main finding we have here is that to a large extent that growth in non-routine content of jobs in the middle-income countries is actually driven by the educational upgrading of the workforce. So some of the countries in the region in late 90s have the tertiary attainment around 20%, and now we have tertiary attainment around 40%. And we find that this the share of tertiary educated people actually correlates quite strongly with the growth of both non-routine cognitive analytical, not so much with cognitive personal, and correlates negatively with the decline of manual jobs. Yeah, with R&D, that's, again, you can see that countries which had more R&D have benefited from the higher growth in this task, but the correlations here are much stronger. And when we try to calculate, decompose the change into this contribution of these correlates, we see that, yes, that the countries that experience the highest growth of the non-routine analytical contents, like Lithuania, Poland, Slovenia, to a large extent, this can be attributed to the workforce educational upgrading, so increasing share of tertiary graduates in the workforce. These are just correlates. So it's not a causality for sure. The contribution of R&D is here much smaller. We also find, I mean, that's in the paper, that the countries which are characterized by gaps here, they had some kind of more egalitarian pattern when it comes to increase of these contents by age. This also can be also visible on the next one. We also find, and this is that the evolution of the routine cognitive, so these bank tellers, accountants, they can't really be. It's also, for example, call centers, which were a big thing for a couple of years in the region. So this is not really related to the growth of this task. Cannot be really explained by the what was happening to the education structure. But it has to be something else. And when we look at the routine manual, again, the decline of the routine manual can be largely explained, but actually what happens to the labor supply, to the changes in the structure of the workforce by education, so people actually staying longer in education, going more often to study, and then let's say that even if there was no technological or structural change, they would be much less likely to perform manual jobs, just let's say by definition. So just to conclude, the questions that we have or challenges is the first. I have to say, slightly surprised by the fact that the routine cognitive task in the regions hold firm. So it sort of like looks that it's still much more profitable to have a computer assistant bank teller doing rather routine cognitive jobs and being paid not that well, rather than have a really well assisted by a computer person doing a much more complicated job and paid much better. On the other hand, the intergenerational divide in the evolution of task contents, it's sort of striking. Maybe that's just the one-off effect due to the fact that the generation born in the 50s and the 60s knew nothing about computers or modern technologies or ICT technology in the middle of 90s, and the entrants were naturally more likely to get these jobs because they just learned it often outside of the school. Whereas the other question is, can the workforce upgrading continue with improving task structure? So the tertiary attainment rates around 40% or even 50% when it comes to current 20-year-olds are actually quite high, and I would doubt that you can just increase and not really see a decline of this task content of jobs that these people hold. And the two questions that are rather like further research is, what is actually the task content of occupations around the world? We are using the US data, but it's likely that, probably Sebastian can elaborate on that, it's likely that the middle and low income countries have more routine contents, both manual and cognitive, with lower wages, and that's probably not accidental. It just probably makes sense in the global division of labor. And I actually think that if people want to focus on this routine bias technological change, it will be really useful to see what's the global evolution of task contents, to see if actually the routine cognitive, routine manual are really declining globally because the technology is substituting for them, or maybe they're just declining in the US, Germany, UK, because the technology is substituting this tax there, but not necessarily in the low and middle income countries, whereas we find they even increase. And that's it. Thank you very much.
So I'm pretty new to this literature, and I enjoyed reading some of the background literature and looking at some of these results. This might be all old to everybody else, but I just wanted to give a brief background to this literature. So typically, a canonical production function equates labor inputs and services. And Acemoglu and Otter, in a 2011 chapter, actually tried to develop a more formal way of disentangling this. And then I primarily read the summary of the literature and the model in the 2013 paper by Otter. And in this literature, production is actually not a function of labor and capital, it's a function of tasks, and each task is assigned different types of labor and a certain amount of capital. And the assignment of these factors is determined by comparative advantage. So they, in like a very simple model, they use sort of constant elasticity of substitution of Y of I, and I is a continuum from 0 to 1 of certain types of tasks that increase and decrease according to complexity. And this Y of I, or the output of each task, depends on 4 different inputs. They use low skilled labor, medium skilled labor, and high skilled labor. And each of these types of labor have a different type of productivity for each different task. And that's just a very basic way of introducing their the task approach to output. And in their 2011 paper, they, in great theoretical detail, which I kind of skipped over, they use it to explain some empirical facts in the US literature, which is non-monotone movements in wage levels. Even when you introduce technology-enhancing improvements, increasing wage inequality and this job polarization. So some interesting results that come out of this model are that factor augmenting technological improvements may not actually increase the real earnings of both skilled and unskilled workers, even though total output is increasing. And they also talk about how, in this model, routine or codifiable tasks are at the greatest risk of machine displacement. Then in the 2013 paper, I thought this was useful to test or to understand this type of way of approaching wages and production. There actually are large empirical and conceptual challenges that hinder that. It's really difficult to measure the mapping between skills and tasks. Our researchers lack shared definitions of core constructs and consistent measures of constructs. There have been different approaches of how to do this. There's low consistency of data, low frequency of updating, and there are different approaches to do this. And in this particular paper, they use the DOT and, or I guess the ONET job descriptors used in the US. And then also a difficulty is if you're trying to run a policy experiment or look at the effect of something, it's actually difficult in constructing counterfactuals because the effect of, say, a technological change depends on each type of worker's alternative productivity at other tasks, which is would require some really heroic assumptions about the productivity of all different types of laborers for all these other tasks. And you'd also need assumptions on the substitutability of all these different types of labor. And so this paper is the first to analyze the evolution of job tasks in transition economies. And I thought this could be interesting because there could be presumably a different process of structural change with, it seems like, similarities to the Western European and American experience. And so they use the EU LFS data and then map it to the ONET descriptors for 1998, not 1988. And there's some, so Piotr presented a lot of results. And it was a little hard for me to interpret all the results. I don't want to like summarize it all over again. But I found it was interesting that it did not seem to find pervasive job polarization. So I'll go right to my comments. Oh, actually, let me summarize it really quickly. It seems that routine manual task intensity decreased in all the CEE countries. They find, this is from the paper, that non-routine cognitive and non-routine manual tasks seem to be converging. They find the mixed results for routine cognitive tasks, which we saw before. And they run some regressions, and they find an association between a greater intensity of non-routine cognitive tasks and the supply of educated labor, and also amounts of R&D. So I have some comments, some of which are not actually on this slide because I just thought of them now. So in general, I think in this literature, if we're going to be looking at the task content of jobs and job polarization, given the model that Otter and also Mowgli put out, you can't look at the task content of jobs independently from the evolution of wages within all these different types of skills. You have to look at both simultaneously to get a sense of what's going on. There's going to be different selection going on, positive or negative, as people go in and out of the workforce. We know that the same type of person who's going to be doing different tasks are going to have different productivity. So if they have a lesser, if the machine comes in and the middle skilled worker has to be forced to do some other task, they may actually have a lower comparative advantage for that new task. So their wages might fall because they have a lower comparative advantage. So all these different things put together, I don't know how, I think it's much better to look at what's going on with wages for all these different types of skills and different types of labor in general simultaneously to be able to interpret what's going on within this model. There's a finding between the supply of highly educated labor and the increase in non-routine cognitive tasks. And I'm just kind of wondering, it's an association, so encourage the authors to think more about which direction the causality runs. And then the last thing is I'm pretty interested in seeing if, in more effort, trying to explain all the country-level differences in the routine cognitive trends. Is there some different access to technology in all of these countries? Are there differences in occupations and industries in Slovenia versus Estonia? So maybe looking into that. Yes, more investigation about the occupational and industry shift in this period for all countries. And also, as I mentioned before, within this routine cognitive trends, could we look at the wage structure of the countries, of the routine cognitive tasks within these countries, see what's going on? Maybe you could develop some more of an intuition of what might be going on. And then also the demographic composition of all the people working are doing these routine cognitive tasks, are they different across the countries? And that might be able to explain the country level differences in the routine cognitive trends. So that's it.
Not working. Yes? No? Yeah? Okay. So I always think of, if you go and look at the ONET, it's this tremendously rich data set. They have almost ridiculous numbers of measures of occupational attributes. I always think of part of the value of what Autor did was to sift through all of that and find a way to categorize occupations into five groups that really summarized a lot of what had happened in the U.S. What you did was sort of say, if I take those same five categories, they don't really apply quite as well to Eastern Europe. In some ways, yes, in some ways, no. But I'm curious if you thought about doing the opposite exercise, which is to try to sift through and find different attributes. Maybe there's some other way to break out occupations or their attributes that would do a better job of telling the story of Eastern Europe. And I don't know if you'd be willing to speculate about what might be different or why. I would be curious.
Shall I go? So I think I have two comments or questions. One is when we want to compare the Eastern Europe to like what polarization other people have found, I'm not sure, you know, because the data you have 98 to 2013, I think maybe we have to draw some benchmark, like maybe you shouldn't be compared to the period. You have to pick the correct period in the US because they have very different level of development. Now, if the change has been non-monotonic, then you have to find the corresponding period in the US, okay, to make the claim, oh, the Eastern Europe is very different. So maybe US back then had a very similar, you know, experience in terms of these five tasks. Now, my second comment is I'm not so sure reporting what happened to these five tasks, we learn anything about polarization. My understanding of the literature of polarization is the x-axis is always defined in terms of wage distribution at a particular point in time. Like Otter and Dorn was defining in 1980, based on 1980 distribution, then we call this occupation in different percentile, we give them a name, and we go back, you know, 20 years later to look at the same occupation, what happened to them. So I'm not so sure you can just draw the conclusion from this task thing. You really have to do the same thing in order to make the comparison. I think the Goose Manning paper is doing the same thing, you know, the x-axis. So I don't think you should go to that point without doing the job.
Okay, this is sort of a, I don't know, a wise guy comment or something, but just harping, I'm going to harp on this whole job polarization literature. You talked about task-biased technical change, but then you showed the evidence that, in fact, the tasks seem to be, it's not clear that this is a supply response, because the evidence seems to be that the tasks people do respond to the supply of labor. So I don't know if this is the same as what Christina was saying, which is that this is sort of like an equilibrium outcome, and it doesn't even to be. This is an argument against Osmoglu and Dorn, but it's completely not identified because you have this unobserved thing, and if you're trying to do anything, it is based completely on structural assumptions.
I think I get your point. Okay, thank you very much for all the comments. So maybe I'll start with the discussant comment. So actually that issue that, okay, I'm gonna stand here so I see you better. So actually that comment that the interplay between the tasks and the education supply or skills that they intertwine, yes, that's absolutely true. The American literature has it quite easier because they say that the education, that the labor supply is exogenous. because if you look at what's the fraction of the graduates on the American labor market, so it increased in the 60s, and then from the middle 70s actually flat, no matter what happens to wages, it's just flat. So the American literature actually made that reasoning, and that's what the author Dorn and others said to argue for the routine bias technological change or task-based technological change, that we have no response in education, the educational structure is flat, so we can attribute the shifts in this task into technology. We don't make a claim to really we don't make a claim that we are testing any of these to try to. We can't really disentangle the labor supply effect from the labor demand slash technology effect. We know we can't really do it with this data because we have no information about the supply of technology, let's say, in these economies. So I absolutely agree with your comment that we don't really test it. It's intertwined, and the point is that if you just look at what's happening with this task content of jobs, like purely statistical terms, and you just say, look, let's take the content of jobs from the late of 90s and then see what happened to the educational structure. Then you can more or less predict the task content of jobs 15 years later without actually talking about some technological change affecting what particular occupations do. So I think that and this is actually a point being made by a few more people in Europe these days, that the conclusion that it's routine technological change was like a little bit drawn too fast, too early. So we don't say it's wrong, we just say, okay, there are other factors in play. When it comes to the interplay, in Europe actually experienced huge increase in tertiary attainment. So there is this workforce upgrading. And of course, we can argue that that was a response to the high wage premium in the late 90s, and also to the fact that the wage premium haven't really declined over the next 15 years. I mean, yes, that's true. We don't go that far to say it's just supply and they are intertwined. When it comes to the polarization debate, the way the Eurostat creates all this EU LFS data actually prevents us from analyzing wages at the same time, because that's some kind of weird privacy issue. So they don't provide you wage data in the data set. We can use the other data set, which is a structure of earnings survey, and it's just not in this paper. And we actually checked that, and this wage polarization, looking at the low-paid, middle-paid, high-paid occupations, what's happening to them 10 years later, how the wages grew, there is no polarization across the region. The only country is Slovakia that experienced something like that, which is like declining share of the middle occupations and flat wages there, increasing share of the high-skilled people and high-skilled qualified occupations and increasing wages there, and the increase in the low-skilled occupations, low-skilled workers with flat wages. All the other countries have experienced something similar to the graph for China, which was like a shift to the right of that distribution 10 years ago, and relatively strong growth of wages actually in the medium of the distribution. So, and sometimes even declining wage inequality, which happened in many countries in the region, especially in Poland over the last few years. So I'll be happy to share some of the paper in the future when we have the pure wage polarization paper then. When it comes to the thoughts, comment about on it, that would be really interesting. But I think that our efforts next year will rather go into using the PIAG data that I mentioned earlier, where they have skill measures for particular countries, and try to apply a consistent methodology to this PIAG data and try to calculate the task contents of occupations in several OECD or low-income, middle-income countries using the STEP data, rather than try to, you know, repackage the American data, so on, so on, so on. So basic, maybe like in a few months we'll have a set of like 40 countries and task content of occupations estimated for particular countries. And then, responding to Rachel's comment, then we could probably see, for example, what are the difference in this task content of particular occupations in Poland or other countries in the region or Vietnam, and compare that to US, and also try to look how it relates to the GDP per capita, for example, if there is any pattern with that. So yeah, I think I finished now. Thank you very much.